Moving on to the clothing, we have the major traditional dresses put on by these people. That is, they wear the shoes or boots known as mulaks, and they have the jackets or trousers known as parkas. These jackets and trousers or parkas are made with the skin of the caribou, which is very soft and at the same time which is very warm for us to maintain themselves from the extreme cold climatic conditions. There is a difference between the dressing of men and women. The men's dress is very long and both sides we have front and the back, whereas the women's dress is a bit shorter when compared to the men's dress. At the same time, these people use the western part or in the northern part of the regions of Greenland, these people like to prefer the seal skin rather than the caribou skin, because this seal skin has the waterproof capability and ability to sustain from the rain climatic conditions also. But the only disadvantage what we have is it's very stiff and not soft at all. And these people decorate their each and every day-to-day things using the fringes like bones, sap stones, all these things, and to maintain their traditional style, and they used to figure it in different ways to sustain themselves. This makes them to get the personal touch. At the same time, they use the different kinds of bones which are very soft and all to maintain their stability and to cover their bodies from the extreme cold climatic conditions. This is about the clothing of the people of Eskimos. What about the other issues of the Eskimos? Moving on to the religious beliefs and the recreational purposes of the Eskimos. How was their religious beliefs? Do they believe in the same religions what we believe? No, these people have a different kind of beliefs. See here, these people believe in the supernatural god name called Scylla. She is a controller of the spirits. They feel that birth, then diseases, then the death, and again reliving, these all are controlled by the spirits. These people believe that spirits have a crucial role to play. These people also believe that they have life after death, and they need to perform many rituals at the time of the birth, at the time of the marriage, at the time of the death. And also they pray in the systematic manner. We have the specialization of people called shamanas, who are specialists in doing the religious activities. When a person dies, the certain group of families are forbidden to do certain kind of tasks. At the same time, even their food habits also, certain group of families are not allowed to take certain kind of fishes because they were forbidden to take that kind of fishes. In this way, they have a different kind of religious beliefs when compared to the other group of societies, the communities which are existing in the world. And moving on to the recreation, they have various kinds of recreation for them, like sealing, the harpoon seals, throwing them, then always having the recreation at the rare times we have for singing, dancing, dumbing, and then at the past of a very big events, like they, when they get a big amount of fish or fat or meat, they do the celebrations for big large marriages and all. They perform these kind of activities like wrestling, and also they fight with each other as a part of the game intensely in order to have a recreation which is fit for their climatic condition. In this way, they have different culture, different kind of recreations when compared to the other people, but they also believe that life after death and everything is controlled by some supernatural power. The name of the supernatural power, who is also the powerful of spirits, who controls the spirits, is Scylla. According to their language, Scylla is the goddess, name of the goddess. Now we will see how did the contacts between the Eskimos and the outsiders establish. What was the basic reason which made the others to come or step into the lives of the Eskimos? See here, we have Viking explorer who came to from Iceland during the period of 1200 to 1400. We don't have the exact dates when did he enter into this. He was the first man who was seen by the Eskimos, a man who established a link between Iceland to the Eskimos during this period was Viking explorer, who explored or maintained the relations or started the barrier, cutting out the barriers and entered into the Eskimos region. Later on, we have the developments done by the English mariner Martin Frobisher, who entered in 1576 to 1578 into the island called Baffin Islands. There he came into contact with the other group of the Eskimos. And later in 1728, Russia entered into the Siberia, And from here, they started to find out the northwestern region are opening into the China, and at the same time from Atlantic, finding out the other alternatives to enter into the European land. And later on, we have the Dutch people entering inside, the Norwegian people entering inside. But even today, later part of the 19th century, many of the Eskimos were not known or in contact with the other parts of the Western people. Then how did they come into contact? What were the effects that were brought in? Because they are living in a traditional custom of their life where they don't have much activities to do here. They have only the activities of hunting and fishing. There is no proper education concept at all. They don't have any systematic government at all. They are scattered. They are not at all united. They only feed on killing animals and store that, and they feed themselves. In this all kind of culture, how kind of changes have been brought inside? How was the lives of the Eskimos got infected or changed? We'll discuss now. So now, by 1850s, the arrival of the Europeans has stepped into the land of the Eskimos. This has brought a great drastic changes in the lives of the Eskimos. That is why it was rightly called by the historians as the boom and bust. What was in the boom? What was in the bust? Now let us recall here. In 1850s, when the Europeans entered inside, they brought the new technical tools which are necessary for the Eskimos to hunt the animals. Instead of running it or making it to run, they can stand at a place and shoot the animal, and they can go and pick the animal. Instead of running it far away, gathering the people, making them to stand in hundreds, or putting the stones in a line, these all efforts were not necessary for them because of the technology which was brought into their hands by the Europeans. With this, the trade concept has increased very much. The trade of whale's fur and caribou and seal's fur has been in an extreme point, that they have to hunt the whales and caribou in some areas to completely extinct, where we don't find any other animal at all. But it has brought in an additional income for the Greenlanders or the Eskimos from the Europeans' point of view. At the same point of time, because of the Europeans are staying in the lands of the Greenlanders, this impact has been to a very high level, that these outsiders has brought new diseases for which the Eskimos don't have the immunity to resist themselves from that kind of diseases, like common cold, cough, diphtheria, pneumonia, tuberculosis, pneumonia, and all these things, influenza, whooping, all these diseases were brought in. And these now outsiders used to stay for the whole long of year in their trade activities of the whale's fur or the seal's fur or the caribou's fur. It has brought in the entire disease into the lands where the people are not even aware of such kind of things. But in the extreme part of 1890s to 1910, 1925, 1950s, they have brought in the new access of education, trade, business, and then development of the naval bases, military bases, increasing the military strength, then connectivity through airways, waterways, modern high ship machinery. All these things has brought advances in the Eskimos' life, but it has created a serious hurdle to the traditional way of Eskimos' life. In this way, the northern region or the polar region has a different existence in the same world where we share the land and air and breathe the same thing what they do breathe, but we have an extremely variant lifestyles in the northern part, and as we move on to the Indian land. Not only the Indian land, in any other corner of the world, you don't find such kind of climatic conditions or the situations of people living here. Now the Eskimos are not with their traditional way of life. Even they got influenced by the diseases, trade, development and modern education, as well as the development of the naval bases, military bases and modern means of transport. They got connected with the other parts of the world through airways, which is very fastest, and the next is the modern ships, which are having high machinery to cut the icebergs and move into inside. In this way, we have a change in the traditional life of the Eskimos from their earlier period to the modern period. That's all for us we have in this lesson.